Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to all. So today I will be presenting the CME lah topic Massive Transmission Protocol. So as an introduction, Massive Transmission Protocol is historically defined as transmission of 10 units of red cells in 24 hours. The most common situation that we encounter the need to transfuse is such as cardiac surgery, GI bleed, AAA trauma and obstetric catastrophe. It involves selection of appropriate amount and type of blood component and associated with a number of hemostatic and metabolic complications. So these are the trauma triad of death, which is which consists of coagulopathy, acidosis and hypothermia. So how are these three related? So first, when the patient have lost a lot of blood and in a shock condition, they may develop hypothermia. So this will in turn reduce the oxygen capacity delivery, and then the cell will become from aerobic state to anaerobic state. This in turn will cause production of the lactic acid and then more severe acidosis and can worsen the coagulopathy. And then, as for lactic acid, it can, if pH is reduced less than 7.2, this condition will reduce the cardiac contractility and can provoke dysarrhythmia. As for hypothermia, it can also decrease the enzymatic process and further worsen the coagulopathy. So this, in fact, highlight the importance of IV fluids and warmer for the patients.
Alright, jap-jap bang. Conclusion kau tu macam pelik sikit. Tak mana pula highlight the importance of IV fluid.
Kau patutnya cakap pasal coagulopathy tu sebab MTP kan?
Yeah. Bila kau bercerita pasal trauma, triad of death, kan cerita pasal IV fluid. Kau kena cerita pasal the importance of initiating early blood product replacement to highlight okay. The principle of replace like with like. Bukan IV fluid. The reason jadi coagulopathy, hypothermia semua ni sebab kau bagi fluid. Excessive IV fluid in trauma. So that's why I think, tak tahu, kau yang previous CME apa semua, ada orang bercerita pasal hypovolemic shock kan? Class 1 sampai class 5 kan? So the importance of recognizing the classes of shock tu, so that kau boleh determine which fluid, with resuscitation fluid yang kau nak start. So, and even dalam lecture sebelum ni pasal primary survey apa semua, in trauma, you don't give more than 2 liters or I think just about a liter of crystalloid. Bukan bagi fluid banyak. We're not interested, we're moving away from volume resuscitation. If you early on kau ada identify patient to having massive blood loss or patient in class 4, class 3, class 4 or class 5 shock, then you need to start blood product rather than fluid. Because giving fluid, excessive fluid ni akan lead to coagulopathy, acidosis, hypothermia, because satu fluid tu sejuk, yang kedua fluid tu tak ada blood cell, tak ada oxygen carrying capacity, and even if you restore the volume, perfusion periphery tu akan sama je lah, akan increase lactic acid. So apa tiba-tiba membebel awal ni sebab conclusion kau daripada triad ni salah. Dia tak boleh cakap IV fluid, the importance of, that's why
initiating early transfusion protocol.
Why kita nak start blood products or blood transfusion early or apa yang dipanggil hemostatic resuscitation. Itu terma dia. So start, supaya clear, supaya jangan ingat bagi fluids in polytrauma. You need to start thinking of giving blood product early. That's why the topic pasal massive transfusion protocol ni. Kita apa, sebelum kau depress, so kita teruskan lah.
Thank you, Atan. Alright, so blood and volume replacement, the primary concern are maintaining is to maintain the cardiac output, oxygen carrying capacity and hemostatic potential. Systolic volume expander can work well for a mild to moderately ill patient lah. However, this can increase the tissue swelling and cause dilutional coagulopathy. So what are the examples of blood components that we have? The first one is packed cell. The second one is fresh frozen plasma, platelet, cryoprecipitate, and whole blood. So for packed cell, the hematocrit is 60%, the plasma concentration is 10% lah. And then for fresh frozen plasma, 80% consists of plasma and 20% consists of anticoagulant. Same for the platelet. For the cryoprecipitate, it is a cold insoluble protein of plasma fibrinogen, factor 8, von Willebrand factor, and factor 13. Okay, so the availability of blood component, for the blood component, as opposed to the duration, for the CFO, we can immediately have the blood product. For the saline cross mesh, it takes about 25 to 30 minutes. For the full cross mesh, 60 minutes and above. And then for the platelet, immediately FFP and cryoprecipitate, it takes a total of 30 minutes to thaw the blood product.
Sekejap,
Alright.
bang. Yang slide tadi, ni yang Hesah punya lah.
Yang mana?
Yang ni Hesah punya lah. Blood bank Hesah lah kata. Saline 30 minutes, full cross match 60 minutes.
Yang ni
Ke
yang
ke yang dalam textbook.
yang ni yang dalam textbook.
So yang Hesah punya dia lain sikit tu. Katanya. Yang full cross match tu
Panjang.
jarang lah dapat 60 minit ni, biasa dapat pakai cakap 2 jam macam tu lah. So that's why kita ada saline cross match, save O, saline cross match dengan full cross match. Tak apalah, tapi this is just a rough estimate lah. Huh? Tak apa, carry on, carry on.
Alright. So HSI MTP protocol, there are two main criteria for activation. The first one is estimated blood loss more than 150 ml per minute, which is 1.5 liter in adult. And then the need for replacement of 50% circulating blood volume in less than 3 hours.
So
Alright.
kalau jap bang, kalau yang replacement 50% blood volume ni hemorrhagic shock class.
Yang ni hemorrhagic class 3 dengan 4.
Hemorrhagic 4 and above lah.
4 and above.
4 tu dia 40% lah, 45%. 3 tu tak tak activate lagi MTP tapi dah kena start pakai blood product. Tapi class 4 and above you need to consider lah activate MTP lah.
Okay.
Okay, carry on.
Alright. So there are two type of hemorrhage. The first one is reveal hemorrhage and the second one is conceal hemorrhage. For the reveal hemorrhage, we have to do the assessment of blood consumption, the ABC score. So what are the criteria? The first one is positive fast scan. The second one is penetrating mechanism. The third one is systolic BP less than 90. And then the fourth one is heart rate more than 120. So if the score we have is 2 or more, then there is a likelihood to activate the message transmission protocol. And then as an additional, there is plus minus anticipate 4 units of RBC in less than 4 hours in a hemodynamically unstable patient and anticipated to have ongoing bleeding. And then in the case where the patient is in severe thoracic abdomen and long bone trauma, and in a major abdomen GI and surgical bleeding. For the conceal hemorrhage, we have to initiate the MTP in class 3 and class 4 hypovolemic shock. For the class 3, blood loss is 1.5 liter to 2 liters and class 4 more than 2 liters. Pulse rate 120, in class 4 more than 120. And then the capillary refill time more than 2 seconds in class 3 and in class 4 undetectable. Urine output 10 to 20 mils per hour in class 3 and 0 to 10 in class 4. For the extremity, pale in class 3, pale and cold in class 4, and for the mental state of the patient, anxious and aggressive in class 3 and in class 4, drowsy, confused and unconscious.
Well, ABC score ni korang biasa dokumen ke? Biasa kira
Tak.
ke in semua patient
Tak,
trauma?
tak. Tak,
Kenapa?
tak, tak.
Adakah dia susah? Susah ke ABC score ni?
So, kalau ikutkan tu.
Soalan kepada semualah, bukan untuk Akmal sahaja.
Tapi tak pernah tengok lagi lah orang buat.
So kalau tak pernah orang buat, tak nak jadi pelopor. You know, batch pelopor. Tak, to be honest, personally, you know, this is something that yang patutnya compulsory for you guys to document. It's not that difficult pun, kan? It's benda yang fairly obvious lah. So try from hari ni, make it a habit bila tengok patient trauma, document ABC score. And senang bila korang nak communicate dengan blood bank, nak activate MTP pun, it makes communication easier lah. ABC score 3, you know. Then diorang pun taklah tanya banyak kan. And these are the things yang biasa diorang nak dengar. You know, saya nak activate MTP, kenapa? Patient polytrauma, ada, you know, perut dia tembus tertikam tiang lampu ke, fast ada free fluid, BP 60 over 40, heart rate 160. Then AAA conveys the information clearly. Tak adalah kena marah dengan blood bank, lepas tu kena marah dengan, you know, team lain kan. So it helps. Or go for macam, you know, patient is class 4 hypovolemic hemorrhagic shock, you know. Orang dah faham lah, tak payahlah kau cerita patient dah pale, cold, clammy, drowsy, confused, apa tak ada. You know, so you need to be familiar with benda-benda macam ni because it makes communication easier, because kita nak efficient kan. Okay, carry on, carry on.
So, if the criteria is not fulfilled, then we have to continue with the secondary survey and transfuse blood component as needed. But if the criteria is fulfilled, then the primary team or NS or ED specialist or MO on call will discuss with the specialist blood bank to activate the MTP. Okay, so what are the packages consist in the MTP? So we have first package and second package. For the first package, it consists of 4 pint of whole blood saline cross mesh and 4 unit of FFP. And then for the second package, we have 4 pint whole blood full cross mesh, 4 unit of FFP, 4 unit of cryoprecipitate and 2 unit of platelet. Alright, these are just the additional blood
so
product that are not
yang
in the MTP.
Korang kena aware ni, selain daripada first package, second package di IVC ni, benda-benda technicalities. You know, satu botol, EDTA tube 3 mils, 2 stiker, 2 form. Sebab ni yang benda ni yang biasa korang buat. And sometimes in the setting of, you know, patient bleeding, hemorrhagic shock apa semua, kita people expect korang dah biasa lah, dah tahulah. Sebab kadang-kadang takut benda ni jadi delay or jadi kacau apabila form tak cukup, sampel darah tak cukup, and akan create delay in receiving the packages. So it's very important for all housemen to be well versed dengan MTP punya protocol. How, when, bila somebody cakap, okay, activate MTP, bukanlah korang baru nak berjalan ke sana, ke sini, tanya macam mana nak activate MTP, borang apa nak kena isi. Are you guys aware that ada actual ring file untuk MTP yang dah siap-siap ada borang apa semua yang Dr. Hafizah dah buat cantik-cantik? Semua orang aware ke kewujudan file itu?
Ada.
Ha. Aku masa orang je aware. Hopefully everybody else is aware as well. Because benda tu di-create untuk memudahkan hidup korang jugalah, supaya korang tak payahlah susah-susah nak berlari cari form apa semua. Nah. Tapi the technicalities, the macam, you know, stiker berapa banyak, borang banyak, yang mana nak bagi, yang mana nak tak ada borang, yang mana nak dan sebagainya, nak sampel, tak ada sampel, itu korang kena aware lah. So, I'm sure semua orang ada experience takut kena marah sebab borang tak betul apa semua masa semua rasa-rasa nak blood kan. Kita nak prevent benda tu lah, because nobody like screaming at everyone lah kan. So macam, okay, be aware benda-benda ni. So saja-saja duduk tu, buka lah folder tu, tengok, be aware about benda ni. Okay, carry on.
Okay, so these are the usual MTP flow. Usually for the houseman, will consist of the circulator and runner. So once the MTP is activated, the circulator need to fill up the MTP form. Basically, it is just the same GSM form but with the MTP stamp, order the stickers and manage the sample. So the circulator then need to pass the form and sticker to the runner, in which the runner have to carry two blood boxes. One is with ice and one is without ice. Why? Because for the ice box, with ice, it can carry the whole blood product, and then for the without ice punya blood box can carry the cryoprecipitate, fresh frozen plasma. Okay, and then the runner will go to the blood bank and wait for the blood product to be ready. Then, once the blood product that are available first, the runner should bring the dead blood product to the OT.
Kalau patient tukar OT lah. Kalau
ha,
patient
kalau
tukar
OT,
jangan bawa pergi OT pula. Itu nak
ha,
kena
dekat mana patient tu adalah. Okay, so while waiting for the first package to be ready, the circulator can already fill up the forms and order the stickers for the second package. If second package is needed, then the circulator can readily pass up the form and sticker to the runner. So the first package is the 4 units of whole blood, saline cross match, and 4 units of FFP. For the second package, 4 pint of whole blood, full cross match, 4 units FFP, 4 units cryo precipitate, and 2 units of platelet. For the subsequent package, is usually exactly as the same as the second package.
Okay, jap, pergi slide yang tadi bang. Okay, so semua orang needs to be aware of the flow lah. Sekarang ni, I think houseman dekat ED ada dekat around 40 kot. So, patutnya tak ada isu lah. Tak cukup orang ke apa semua. So, biasalah. Kalau dalam situasi sekarang, benda ni dia nak jadi, dia most likely akan jadi dekat yellow lah. Kan? Patient trauma biasa main kat yellow kan? So, kalau dulu benda ni biasa berlaku dekat red sebab patient yang teruk masuk red. Tapi sekarang sebab kita respi non respi biasanya benda ni berlaku dekat yellow. So kalau korang realize benda ni nampak macam complicated, tapi yang pentingnya dalam konteks bila activate NTP tu semua orang kena clear role masing-masing. So siapa, you know, somebody need to dalam ramai-ramai houseman yang ada, seorang kena decide siapa jadi circulator dan siapa jadi runner. Dan circulator dan runner kena tahu peranan masing-masing. Baru tidak berlaku confusion. Sebab kalau tiba-tiba semua sibuk nak jadi circulator, tak ada orang jadi runner, ataupun semua sibuk nak jadi runner, tak ada circulator, dia akan menyebabkan benda ni jadi tak efisien lah. That's why benda ni kena biasakan. Okay, so yelah, dan sebab itulah kita galakkan semua orang pakai kasut sukan kan, sebab nak jadi runner. Tapi anyway, so be aware of the flow. Nah, semua bila kena role tu kena clear. Bila berlaku reactivate NTP, cakap okay, saya jadi skeletor, awak jadi runner. Or vice versa lah. Tapi semua orang kena tahu role masing-masing. And of course skeletor tu kenalah tahu folder NTP tu ada dekat mana supaya senang nak cari borang dan sebagainya. Dia benda ni technicality je. Benda ni tak ada complicated pun. It's just bila activate MTP, korang kena tahu apa korang kena buat. Bukan masa activate MTP tu baru nak tanya situ, tanya sini. So, benda yang sepatutnya cepat, dia jadi lambat. Okay? Carry on.
Okay, so for the monitoring, in massively transfused patient, we have to have the assumption of possible PT, APTT and platelet count post-transfusion, usually after the administration of every 5 to 7 units of red cells. So what are the endpoint of resuscitation? There are 5 units that we can observe. The first one is HB and hematocrit, which is more than 8 gram per deciliter, and hematocrit 25%. And then platelet count more than 50, PT less than 1.5, APTT less than 1.5, and fibrinogen more than 1.5 gram per liter. So what are the complications of massive jangan transfusion?
Slide tadi. So when do we check FVC balik?
Usually after 5 to 7 unit of
red cell. After cycle ke? Apa package ke?
Package
kan,
kedua.
1, 2, 3 package kan? So kena ingat eh, macam Akmal cakap, after 5 to 7 pints of, you know, pack cell masuk lah, kena repeat lah ABC. Tapi biasanya hopefully patient tu tak adalah stay kat kita sampai 8 pint masuk, patutnya dah bergerak ke OT lah. Tapi in the event that patient masih ada sini, korang kena aware jugalah ABC tu nak kena repeat. Nah, and this is end point of resuscitation. Maksudnya kalau dah achieve ni, benda yang selalu orang lupa adalah activate MTP tapi tak deactivate. Sebab selagi korang tak formally stand down or deactivate MTP, blood bank akan keep processing the packages. Okay, so kena ingat juga benda tu. Ha? Once kalau dah sampai target ni, kadang-kadang tanyalah nak nak deactivate ke MTP. Biasanya jarang lah berlaku deactivate MTP dekat ED. Sebab benda tu ongoing kan. Dia biasa stand down or deactivate dekat OT. Tapi in case lah MTP tu ber-ongoing dekat ED, then kena fikir juga pasal stand down or deactivate MTP. Okay, this is usually one of the complaints yang selalu dapat lah dari luar bank. Activate tapi tak pernah deactivate. Okay, carry on.
So, what are the complications of massive transfusion? The first one is citrate infusion, in which the large amount of citrate in blood component can act as anticoagulant. And then we can have a low ionized calcium level. This will lead to paresthesia and cardiac arrhythmia. And the last one is metabolic acidosis due to the metabolism of citrate into bicarbonate. Okay, that's all. So, thank you.
Balik kepada slide complication tu. So, macam mana nak kalau berlaku large amount of citrate ni, how to avoid or how to treat?
Bagi IV fluid.
Bagi IV fluid lagi. Tak dengar. Dah bagi pula, bagi lagi IV fluid. Tu low ionized calcium tu.
Calcium. Bagi kalsium lagi.
Kalsium apa?
Kalsium gluconate.
Ha. Oh, ada yang berbisik di sebelah. Tentanglah Anis ada di sebelah. Okay, so be aware of the complication of massive transfusion. Eh? That's why the citrate itself tu, I mean, it's gonna be difficult lah. Tapi that's why kadang-kadang dalam massive transfusion protocol, kita nak bagi fresh blood lah, fresh whole blood. Because fresh whole blood ni masih ada dia punya apa coagulation factors dan sebagainya lah, yang kadang-kadang dah depleted daripada packed cell. Huh? So be aware lah pasal citrate ni. Nak tak nak blood untuk dia, citrate ni memang kena bubuh dalam packed cell so that darah tu tak clotted lah. Tapi bila you but the more packed cell yang you bagi, you bukan bagi packed cell saja, you bagi everything yang ada dalam packed cell tu lah, termasuk citrate ni. Huh? And so of course citrate ni low ionized calcium level ni pun is as a result of the excessive citrate tu lah. So bila tak cukup calcium ni, selain daripada paresthesia dan cardiac arrhythmia tu, adalah coagulopathy. Because coagulation pun is dependent on calcium level. So kadang-kadang tak payah tunggu level calcium low pun. Once you dah bagi macam you rasa dah bagi 5-6 pint tu, I think you kena consider jugalah bagi calcium gluconate along with your ni. Or bila you tengok dekat VBG calcium low pun, you kena start replace lah the calcium tu. It will help with the coagulation. Nah, okay. So paling penting dalam benda-benda ni adalah you need to be aware bila activate MTP protocol. So ni kebanyakan ni basically kerja houseman lah ni, nak suruh orang tua macam saya berlari pergi blood bank pun saya tak tahu kat mana. Mungkin sesat dululah. So korang ni yang sudah masih muda, BMI masih ideal semuanya ni, korang lah yang kena berlari pergi blood bank dan sebagainya. Nah, untuk ni, kena be aware. The folder, the forms, sub sticker berapa banyak, apa nak kena bawa, apa expectation first package, second package dan sebagainya. Nah, because biasanya bila NTP ni activated, bukan team ED je lah kalau ada kat ED. Dia akan ada team surgical, team ONG dan everybody be, you know, macam kata-kata ayam lah. Ayam apa panggil? Macam ayam lah, duk bising-bising semua. Tapi, you know, semua orang duk push-push lah. Cepatlah, mana blood kan? It's very chaotic. And ini adalah antara masa yang korang tak nak kena marah lah. Sebab bukan seorang je akan marah korang. Semua akan marah korang. Dan yang kedua, just be aware. I think maybe from maybe next week or the week after, kita akan start ada Safe O dekat ED eh. Korang aware tak?
Tak.
Safe O akan start place dekat ED. Maksudnya sebelum ni CFO korang kena ambil kat lab kan? Ha, bila somebody kata okay nak CFO, tak activate MTP lagi, nak CFO kan, nak cepat daripada saline cross match. Oh sekarang oh kalau patient dekat
Sarin,
PUS semua semua pakai CFO kan.
Betul.
So maybe next week or the week after, peti sejuk dah ada. We will start simpan CFO dekat ED. Biasa dalam ni lah, dekat tempat yang korang buat ABG, red zone punya ABG tu. Okay, so last week saya ada share link eh, yang dengan link yang lecture daripada Blood Bank pasal penggunaan CFO dekat ED. So hopefully bila tak boleh tidur malam tu, buka lah tengok. Dia akan bantu anda tidur lah selain daripada menambah pengetahuan. So tengok lah, sebab once CFO dah ada, kita expect korang aware lah CFO tu ada. Tak adalah bila kata nak CFO, ada orang pergi lari pergi lab pula. So akan ada dekat ED dan korang should be aware of the procedures. Form apa, apa semua untuk ambil CFO tu. Walaupun CFO tu ada kat ED, still form semua kena isi. Taklimat yang lebih lanjut akan diberikan lah once dah betul-betul dah ada. Tapi be aware. Lepas ni kita nak ada CFO dekat ED.
Maksudnya akan ada MLT Blood Bank ke doktor dekat ED?
Ada. Ada peti sejuk je.
Okay.
So tapi form semua mesti kena isi. Mesti ada-ada yang akan jagalah. Dia bukan senang-senang buka peti ambil. Okay, sebab dia ada prosedur untuk replace dan sebagainya. Tapi at least it save us the time lah. Tak adalah. Nak save O pun, apa, the weakest link is kadar kelajuan korang berlari pergi blood bank kan. So at least save O tu dah ada when we need it. Tapi the procedures tu kita akan detail out lah macam mana. Tapi introduction to the process tu, tengoklah lecture daripada blood bank tu. Malam-malam bosan-bosan tak ada patient ke, you know. So okay, any questions about it's fairly straightforward. Cuma benda ni korang kena aware there is such thing as massive transfusion protocol. Be aware sebab prosedur benda ni untuk setiap hospital walaupun dalam satu negeri berbeza-beza. Semua bergantung. It's very specific to HESA. It's usually berbeza bergantung kepada facility dan policy, local policies lah of blood bank. Okay, awak pindah hospital lain, nama mungkin MTP juga tapi activation dia mungkin lain sikit, prosedur dia lain sikit. And kalau kat HESA ni, biasanya dia orang akan announce lah kat PA system. MTP activated dekat wherever. Ada soalan tak? Kalau ada soalan, boleh tanya Dr. Hafizah lah. Dia yang hebat sekali pasal MTP ni. Tapi dia tak ada dalam ni. Bila-bila jumpa dia, tahan lah dia. Dr. Hafizah, saya ada soalan pasal MTP. Okay?
Okay, tu.
Okay. Dr. Husna ke, Dr. Vila ke, Dr. Farah ke, dia nak tambah apa-apa? Kalau tak ada, kita proceed to the next lecture lah. CME ya, tajuk.